Good morning, everyone. As Nate indicated, I'm Steve Metz of the Strategic Studies Institute, and I would like to welcome you to what on my own calendar is described as the Swan Panel. By my own personal inclination, I'm always most interested in the aspects of national security, the aspects of strategy that are kind of at the far edge, the out of the box, the creative, the new sorts of things. So as Nate and our other colleagues in the Strategic Studies Institute were putting this conference together a number of months ago, and he mentioned that he wanted to have a panel on black swans and gray swans, things we might not be thinking about or not thinking enough about, you know, I said, please throw me into that briar patch. That's exactly the sorts of things that I find most interesting. Now, I assume everyone here is familiar with the idea of black swan events. I mean, it's been in the lexicon in business and national security for a long time. It was an idea, of course, initially popularized by author Nassim Nicholas Taleb. And a black swan, as we all know, is an event that's hard, maybe even impossible to predict, and very rare, but which has a major impact when it occurs. And I'll tell you that until I was preparing for this this panel, I hadn't heard of the idea of gray swans. That was something that's sort of new to me. But a gray swan is an important event that can be anticipated to an extent, but is still unlikely. And in a lot of ways, as I thought about it, I said, you know, gray swans may be the thing that we really want to concentrate on because it is somewhat possible to expect or anticipate. As the Strategic Studies Institute developed this panel, we've been very lucky to do so in partnership with the Global Security Program of the National Intelligence Council. So as we begin, I would like to express my thanks to them. We have an all-star lineup here today. You all have their biographies, so I'm not going to recount them, but just to place names to faces. From the far end down, we have Dan Flynn of the National Intelligence Council's Global Security Program, Michael Horowitz of the University of Pennsylvania, Maura Sullivan, who currently is at the Department of the Navy, and Nadia Schadlow of the Smith Richardson Foundation. The way I want to run this panel is really as a free-flowing discussion. So what I've asked the panelists to do is rather than start with a prepared statement in sort of a normal conference method, what we're going to do is I'm going to simply pose a question to all of them and let them go with it. And then what I would like to do is to then immediately move into the discussion mode with questions, comments, expansions from the audience, and we'll just sort of see how it goes. I would like to apologize a little bit for the sound of my voice. Like most of the free world, I've been suffering from sort of an allergy thing that's moved into my lungs recently. Let me just say that I don't think I'm as infectious as I sound, but I gave a talk in Washington earlier this week, and I literally lost my voice after about 10 minutes, so probably that's a good thing. So I just kind of point this out because I would like you to help me with this, challenge the panelists, ask them to expand as you think appropriate. And what I'm going to do is we're scheduled to go to 11 o'clock. I found out that there was a typo in the printed program, but Nate has told me to stop at 11. So I want to have a discussion up to till there's about 10 minutes left in the panel. Then I'm going to give the panelists an opportunity to make a closing statement if they so desire, to bring up anything that hasn't come up in the discussion, or kind of put a punctuation mark at the end of the sentence. So with that said, what I'm going to do is pose a question to all the panelists, and we'll start with Dan at the far end and move down. And that simply is, considering probability, impact, the state of U.S. preparation, what black or gray swan worries you the most? What keeps you up at night? Dan?
Thanks, Steve. And before I start, I just want to thank the Army War College for allowing us, the National Intelligence Council, to be a partner on this panel and to for being here today. Let me start. I came up here from Washington, so I'm going to follow the Washington tradition of not responding to a direct question with a direct answer. And I really like to think about differently about black swans. I mean, as Steve said, black swans are unpredictable. So how do you talk about them? And we can talk about low probability, high impact scenarios, and we talked to some of those in our last Global Trends report. We mentioned financial crisis, sudden climate change, pandemic, next use of nuclear weapons. But the problem is we can come up with these scenarios all day long, and that's, you know, the old joke about intelligence analysts, we can find the cloud in front of every silver lining. So we'll come up with more threats than you guys as defense planners can come up with contingency plans and resources to address them. So I like to turn the problem on its head. Let's accept that the world is chaotic, and we'll have disruptive events. And then the question we should be thinking more about is how are we prepared for those, and which countries, which regions of the world are even less prepared to handle those disruptive events? Because that's where the crisis will occur. And this thought about turning the problem on the head actually was discussed just recently in a Foreign Affairs article by Greg Trevenin, the chairman of the National Intelligence Council, who spoke to you yesterday at lunch, and Nassim Taleb, who wrote The Black Swan. And they said, we should be looking at the fragility of certain states and see how they can cope with the disruptive events. And they came up with five criteria to look at. Whether a state has a centralized government system, whether a state has an undiversified economy, whether they have an excessive national debt, a lack of political variability, and finally, no recent history of surviving these kind of past shocks. And if they applied those criteria around the world, they found a number of countries that have some varying degree of fragility, including Bahrain, Egypt, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Brazil, Japan, Greece, Turkey, Russia, Nigeria, and Venezuela. But the one that stood out was China. You look at China, it has all five of these criteria of fragility. It's a centralized government, an economy that's overly dependent on exports, a recent increase in government borrowing. And as China moves away from its past shocks of the Cultural Revolution, it may be less inclined to handle future disruptive events. So I think the black swan that we should be thinking about is the potential for a disruptive event, wherever that may be, an economic collapse, an environmental challenge in China. How will Beijing respond to that? What impact that will have on the rest of the world? And how is the international community going to respond to that kind of event in China?
Thank you. Maura?
So thank you for including me on this uplifting topic. And just a little bit on my background, I am spent most of my career in the insurance and financial industry, so I am very new to the defense side of things, so I will definitely have that bent. So when I think about black swans from a philosophical point, I agree with you. It doesn't actually help to spend that much time thinking about the black swans. It is the gray swan area. So as a statistician, I mean, I think of the black swan, we should be looking at 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 10,000 and further out in the tail type events, which means if we feel like we're seeing them more than about once a century or a couple times a century, our aperture is not open wide enough with what we're considering in our everyday possibilities. I think most of what we will see is correlations of low probability events that occur at the same or concurrence, which then creates an even further tail event. So I'm actually going to talk about one particular one that I think keeps me up at night. And it's a two-part event, and it's enabled by the information age. And that is a destabilization that is large enough that allows another actor to come in, particularly a non-state actor. So if I think about how you would set this up, it really requires the 1-2 punch of destabilization of traditional faith and authority, followed by a destabilization of societal fabric and the way it exists. And I think all of the tools to do that exist today. So we have an information age, and we have a press corps that cares a lot more about, or cares less about truth than they ever have in the past. And so perception becomes more and more important. We have fundamental distrust in authority happening through things like Ferguson in South Carolina. We have it through what's happening in the information age. So you could push with what we have in the information age in almost in a non-kinetic way, just slowly undermine authority. So you start to shake faith in the Federal Reserve. You start to shake faith in the ability of law enforcement. You start to shake faith in the ability of the United States government to safeguard individual information. Then the final straw has to be some sort of kinetic casualty-causing attack against U.S. civilians using U.S. assets. And I think that would be enough of a setup for phase two. So phase two is, how do you begin to undermine faith between individuals? I see two easy ways to do that. One requires is a little bit longer, so the second one's really the easy one. And that is individual person-to-person pressure. So you can do that by reducing resources and having a step change in something like longevity. So for instance, a cure to cancer, which would have an enormous economic resource push in a short period of time. But far easier to do this, to create distrust individual-to-individual, is infectious disease. We have the ability to do that right now. We've got smallpox, we've got virulent flu viruses. You create one of those, while you have distrust in authority, you can fundamentally undermine our ability to collaborate as a social fabric between individuals, and you have no faith of looking towards government authorities. And that could be a very significantly destabilizing event. So then the question becomes, why would you want to do this? Or who would want to do this? And I don't think I hope there's no obvious candidates, but I can see a world where the state actors are no longer in the best interest of multinational corporations. And there are multinational corporations that have more trust, more information, and more available resources to be able to come in and respond in an event like this in a place where the government couldn't. And so for me, when I think about what a vision of a correlated series of events that could relate to sort of a black swan event, that's sort of the picture I would paint.
Michael?
Well, now that she's laid out the Hunger Games come to life, as an academic who's also serially incapable of answering the question that I'm asked, I want to start by saying that I'm actually confident in our ability to lay out scenarios, and that when we think about black swans or gray swans, I suspect that nearly all of the most important security developments that will happen over the next generation will have either come up in the last couple of days, will come up on this panel, or will come up later today. In that if you look at nearly all of the most important events that looked like black swans in history, someone always predicted them. There's always, there's always the one-eyed man who, turned out to be king. The question is, how do you recognize that person is right? And I think, I would start by saying, I think one of the most important things we can do, it's not necessarily about identifying what's the particular way that something bad happens. It's actually about how we assess probability and allocate resources to try to deal with particular situations. Now, the particular thing that keeps me up at night also has to do with China, but rather than China falling apart, it's more a failure of imagination on our part. The thing that I worry about is a world 20 to 25 years in the future where there's some kind of future conflict and the United States sends up into the air over say a certain strait the best fifth generation fighters that money could buy, and dear God, let's hope they're good. We have F-35s and F-22s up there, and they can take out adversary planes at a ratio of about 10 to 1. But our adversaries are flying aircraft that are remotely controlled or even autonomous that are produced at a cost differential of about 20 to 1. That's a cost curve that we'd be on the wrong side of. And the challenge when you're number one, when you're the United States, is to not rest on your laurels. Because every day we wake up as a military, as a national security community, we look at the mirror and say, well, what should we do? We should do what we did yesterday, because we were number one yesterday and we're number one today. So if we keep doing that, we'll probably be number one tomorrow. And that's true unless you hit that sort of tipping point, unless there's a failure of imagination in how we integrate new technologies into the national security community. And I've called out essentially robotics and autonomous systems potentially as one, but one could imagine others, including cyber, there's certainly metamaterials, others as well. And so For me, what I worry about is I laid out that one scenario, but it's not necessarily just that scenario, as it is a systematic failure over time to be imaginative and take chances within the national security establishment, which means that one day you wake up and then you're not number one. And that's not a world I want to be in.
Like my fellow panelists, I'm also going to avoid the direct scenario. I also was going to use a term like probability, but once I found out I was on a panel with an actual statistician, I thought I would stay away from the term probability. So I thought I would talk about actually four or five conditions that generate black swans or gray swans. What are the conditions that might generate black swans and also affect our ability to respond to them? So I'm going to throw four out there, and we can debate them or discuss them a little bit. The first, as I see it, is the democratization of violence, which goes to some of the other points. Lots of non-state actors at all different levels have access to really powerful weapons today. You can have state-level effects, essentially, but not necessarily controlled by the state. The second, and probably this affects our ability to respond to disruptions, is what you might call the crippling of the liberal democratic state, the stifling bureaucracy of the state, in some ways Maura's point, the potential for uncertainty and lack of confidence in the state's ability to respond, a sense of political uncertainty. So in some ways I'm speaking about the West in general, compared to actors at the non-state level that can act quickly with agility, or authoritarian states that can respond because they write the rules, they break the rules, and they can respond much more easily as they see fit. However, actually, that's a different point, actually, than Dan's point, and maybe we could talk about that a little bit. Is China brittle, or is it able to respond because of certain aspects of its centrality at the state? Velocity is another condition that many people have talked about, but is pretty important. It requires a lot of knowledge going into a situation, right? It's the thinking fast, thinking slow paradigm. You have to react quickly, but you also have to understand what's happening quickly. So there are chances of escalation, and that also could lead to black swans. And then fourth, we've talked about this a lot throughout the day, yesterday, the hybrid war situation, the persistent conflict problems that can then lead to various forms of escalations and problems. And undergirding, I think, all of these four conditions is what I think is the primacy of politics, that in the end, if we are going to think about predicting the future, we have to begin from that political level of the politics driving the disruptions and maybe shift from our focus on capabilities, which seems to be paramount these days, and continue to relook at politics and the intentions behind capabilities. Capabilities alone do not tell the story, I think, of what will drive black swans.
Well, since no one else will answer my question, let me take a chance to answer it myself. I write a weekly column called Strategic Horizons for World Politics Review, so this idea of kind of the long-term futures, cutting edge, out-of-the-box things is something that I get an opportunity to kind of play with a little bit on a weekly basis. So let me just throw two of my own concerns into the mix. And the first one is kind of a nearer term, maybe a grayer swan. The second one is longer term and maybe a blacker swan. The nearer term grayer swan that worries me a lot is, as Dan mentioned, a nuclear exchange somewhere in the world. And I think the scenario that scares me the most is North Korea. I mean, I consider North Korea the most frightening place on Earth today. And as I kind of look at the unfolding of the security environment, I think that there is at least enough of a probability that that regime will use nuclear weapons in coming decades, that it's something that that we as a nation, as a military, as an army should be thinking about. My longer term and blacker swan is something a little more extreme, and that's the emergence of what futurists call the singularity, which is the point at which you have some sort of merging of organic and inorganic beings, machines, thinking, or whatever. You know, that we reach a point, and who knows when it will be, 2040, 2050, or whatever, where it becomes harder and harder to distinguish between what is a real human and what is a machine that's human-like. So I think that those are two things that I at least try to think about what the U.S. response, the U.S. military response, and the U.S. Army response might be. So now we've kind of tabled a number of ideas. Is there, first of all, let me ask, is there anyone in the panel that would like to question one of the other panelists or, no? Okay. Okay, anyone in the audience who would like to, at this point, drive in one of these directions that we've that have been laid out here? Okay, yes, ma'am.
Hello, Mary Manjikian. I'm struck when you all describe the different scenarios by the fact that there seem to be three different levels of analysis that you use when you think about it. Some of you have described these kind of long-term, kind of deterministic things that occur over time, you know, like a demographic change. Some of you refer to perhaps something that's an accident, someone accidentally launches something. And then in some instances, you talk about sort of, you know, agency, someone making a choice to inflict a particular scenario. And I'm just wondering in your own minds how you kind of sort out those three different kind of whys. You've all kind of described a what, but I'm interested in sort of how you think whatever the black swan is might come about. Is it going to be, you know, accidental? Is it going to be a choice? Or is it going to be something more long term?
Great question. I'd like to take that on.
Yes. I think it can be all those things, right? And that's what we really have to pay attention to. So some of these things are long-term trends that we see occurring over time, the march of biotechnologies and the issues of food and water scarcities and things like that. But some may become a black swan because we misinterpret how others are thinking and behaving, and they do something that we're not expecting. And so that's important as well. And there can certainly just be plain accidents that neither side may want to go into a conflict thinking they'll end up in war. But again, because of misjudgments, misperceptions, that's where it ends up. So I think we have to pay attention to all three of those things.
And the deliberate acts. I mean, right. EMP, if we want to talk specifically, EMP is one where lots of people, I mean, it used to be considered a fringe issue. It's now moved much more toward the center, less fringe, and more possible, and that could be a deliberate act as well.
I think this is a place where perspective really matters and outcome matters. So, I mean, if I think back to work with insurance, do they really care why? Is it really just about outcome? If I could build a model that correlated the number of cats in Carlisle, Pennsylvania perfectly with some casualty outcome, does it matter that there's causality or is correlation enough? And I think, you know, that's an interesting issue because sometimes causality matters and sometimes it's really just about the correlation and just about the outcome side. So it does very much matter from which perspective you're posing the question. If you're trying to understand a path leading up to it, sometimes you care if it's a causal path and sometimes you just care if you can pull out some correlated. Because oftentimes we cannot understand causality until we're looking back.
And I just add that I think it's one of the biggest challenges from a strategic planning perspective is you need something at all three of those levels of analysis. You need to be, you know, focused on those macro level trends because those macro trends then constrain behavior down the road. And you need to be focused on the possibility for accidents because there are some situations where you just don't care exactly why it happened. The point is something really bad just happened. But then there are certainly cases where you want to understand the way that leaders make decisions, the way that militaries make decisions, things like the risk of a coup in important countries. So I think all three of those things are actually important. And I think one of the biggest challenges we face is that it's a lot easier for us to focus on the micro and to look at the, you know, change from yesterday to today than it is to try to, even thinking about it from a statistical perspective, if you're going to try to model it, to try to understand how those macro trends play out down the road.
And let me add that something I've done for really the last, I guess, 15 years or so has been involved at least at the edges in the U.S. Army's very active kind of long-term futures program. I mean, we used to have the Army After Next program. We now have the Unified Quest program. So there are a lot of really smart people within the Army, both in uniform and civilians, who spend time thinking about deep futures and this sort of thing and what it would mean for U.S. land power and for the Army. I think within that framework, there is, while it might not be articulated as such, people draw a distinction between the sort of macro trends that are environmental factors that will influence the way that we do business, but that we probably can't, we certainly can't stop, and we might not be able to alter in any way. Global warming, urbanization, interconnectedness, things like this are big trends that are going to affect the United States, the U.S. military, the U.S. Army, and we have to think about that. But, you know, the U.S. Army isn't going to change urbanization or interconnectedness or things like that. But the other sorts of things that you mentioned that were deliberate events or even accidents are things that I think people thinking about the future within a military context say, okay, given the possibility that this might happen, it would be a bad thing, what can we do now to try to lower the probability of that? And that's where, you know, for example, to take the ideas that I threw out, the idea of a North Korean use of nuclear weapons would fall into the category of an agency sort of thing that we might be able to take steps now to lower the chances of something like, you know, the emergence of the singularity, if it happens, would be one of these kind of big long-term trends that will affect the way we do business. But we in the Army, in the military, or even in the government probably can't do a whole lot to change it one way or the other.
Yep. Gene Germanovich, I was wondering if in the intelligence community or perhaps academia, you've had a chance to examine, I'm sure, past events and what kind of insights you've gotten from looking back as to how to look to the future.
I know. Certainly in the intelligence community, the history is always the guide to the future. Trying to think about where things will go. And in our past global trends, we've been doing them, working, I think, on the sixth one right now. And we've gone back to the previous ones to look at what we didn't get right or what we missed. And so we're always trying to learn from those past events to see, you know, can we get better at picking up the leading indicators that will give us cues about what's coming? So that is an important thing to do.
I would say if you think the past predicts the future, go drive home looking in your rearview mirror. And I think that that's one of the great mistakes people make, especially in this data-heavy world. We all said, let's mine the data and it'll give us a view of the future. Statistical modeling and predictive modeling are two very different animals, and they require two very different skill sets. And so, I mean, I would say, yes, you want to have an underlying statistical model. You want to use back prediction. But it is far more important that you actually start to build the underlying structural models to some of the trends that you're seeing. So for instance, just something everyone is familiar with, human longevity, right? It was basically 35 years, 40 years since the dawn of civilization until about 150 years ago. And then you look at prediction trends, and they were always way underestimating because we didn't understand the underlying structural trends with the sanitary revolution, the underlying structural trends with the infectious disease revolution, the underlying structural trends with the cardiovascular disease revolution. So as you look at your past data, that's great, but make sure that you are clearly modeling what's going on a structural aspect as well as on a statistical aspect.
Yeah, I think that's basically right. I would push back a little bit only to say that, I mean, there are some things that we, you know, you look at enough history and you, especially when you have enough data that you can start modeling it, that seem like important trends, like democracies generally don't fight each other. And if you have negative population growth in your country for a sustained period of time, that is really bad for whether you're going to be a global power long term. But that doesn't necessarily tell you what will happen in any individual case. It gives you the baseline from which you then need to, you know, understand the particulars of situations.
Just to challenge you on that one, because I think that brings up an interesting point. So, for instance, you mentioned the concept of negative population growth, and that is historically very relevant. But if we bring in the concept of singularity and autonomy, you could actually definitely see where we have a structural swing right now where the past is not going to predict the future.
No argument.
But within that debate about technology and structural issues, where does human agency come in and how you take the fear, honor, interest, sort of the human element, the political, the intentions, and that's maybe the point at which there's a not a, a tension, but certainly a point for discussion of how they come together. And actually, I would ask, so, you know, because actually Maura's points in some ways are a combination of the two in the sense of the lack of confidence in the state, your earlier point, which essentially comes down to the politics of people not having confidence in the state, and then the bigger structural data technology-driven factors, and how do the two interact?
As I'm sure you know by now, one of the really important innovations of this conference over the past few years is the integration of a global virtual audience. And you know, as you probably know, we also have a means to take questions via Twitter or email from the virtual audience. So we now have a question that I'll pose to the panelists from Dave DeBlay. I see it on the screen here, so I'll read it so that you in the room know what we're talking about. The question is, do you see any potential for domestic threats that could cause a gray or black swan to occur within U.S. borders?
Clearly, I do.
I think the democratization of violence applies to that issue as well. Domestically, there are individuals or actors or criminal groups that also have access to technology and to weapons in ways that were different than in the past. So,
I mean, I think at least a couple of people reported in public have been arrested over the last few years for attempting to take the unmanned aerial vehicle that you could buy online for $500, put some explosives on it, and fly it into a federal building. I think the democratization of violence, especially combined with maybe something like 3D printing, means that the availability of the ability to conduct violence even within the borders of a country like the United States are going up. And that's certainly something that we need to be aware of. That being said, I actually tend to think America's pretty resilient and strong, and we'll be okay.
Yeah, I would agree. When we talk about fragility of states, I do think the United States is pretty resilient and strong. I think the one, threat that a lot in the intelligence community worry about is, of course, a massive threat to our critical infrastructure, somehow causing a widespread disruption. That would certainly be something we haven't dealt with in the past and may have unpredictable results.
EMP, cyber, water supply.
Right.
So I totally agree with that, but I would take one that I find a little more threatening that's slow to evolve. So, again, back to the infectious disease analogy. HIV was much more insidious than Ebola. And the reason is because it was there a very, very long time before we knew it was there. And I would argue that there's a very good chance that something that will eventually become a gray swan already exists in some of that infrastructure. And so, it's just a question of how it's going to develop and when it's going to develop and if it's intentional, how that's going to correlate with other factors.
Let me just sort of tease out a concept that that Dan and Michael both mentioned in the replies there, and that's the concept of resiliency, because it's kind of a basic idea in futures thinking is that since it's really hard or impossible to precisely predict, certainly black swans, maybe even gray swans, that the best you can do to be prepared for them if or when they occur, is to have a society that is as resilient as possible. And so we talk about resilient societies, resilient systems, resilient economies versus brittle or fragile ones. Let me just kind of pose a question to the panelists here, to all of the panelists is, you've both indicated, or Dan or Michael, you both indicated you think the U.S. is pretty resilient now. What could we be doing to make ourselves as a nation even more resilient to black or gray swans?
Well, I think the resilience has two components. One is you're sort of able to take a hit and roll with it. So we are not fragile in the sense that when a disruptive event happens that we totally fall apart. But the other part of resilience is that you actually can then take some actions to take advantage of whatever happened. And so the fact that we maintain a global military force that is adaptable to key changes and inflexible enough to respond to unforeseen events, I think is a huge advantage for our country. And so it means we not only can, like I said, take the hit, but we can adapt and respond to whatever comes up.
I would say that it's, when I say America's resilient and strong, it's not that I think that we don't have problems, it's just that I bet just about everybody else in the world would trade their problems for ours. And the, when I think about things I worry about in that space, it's actually underlying decay in the sort of science engineering base of the country. I mean, we already know, you know, we already have this sort of trend since the end of the Cold War where, you know, a lot of the best science engineering talent in the world goes to Silicon Valley, goes to Wall Street, essentially, whereas in the early mid Cold War, a lot of that talent was going into the defense industry. And, you know, part of that's because in the early mid Cold War, it seemed like the coolest problems to solve were in the defense industry. And now it's not just that it doesn't seem like they're the coolest problems to solve, it's also that you can make a whole lot more money not being in the defense industry. And so is that issue important, essentially, and how do we address it? Maybe it's not if we can figure out new ways to take advantage of private sector innovation and bring that into the defense sector, or maybe it's not if we can figure out new ways to attract really talented people into science and engineering. But I think one of the underlying things that makes me confident the United States is resilient is our strength, underlying strength in science and engineering. And if that was threatened in one way or another, I would become less optimistic.
And maybe one way of thinking about the question of resiliency is to go back again to conditions. I guess I'm maybe less optimistic than Mike in that you could also look at conditions that today suggest that maybe we're becoming less resilient because of the bureaucracy of the state, the stifling of ideas. There isn't, to use an Army term, sort of mission command sort of in the day-to-day level of the way many of us can operate day-to-day. And so that might actually be a topic for one of you to consider. What are the conditions that seem to promote resiliency, and are they increasing or decreasing? To go back to Dan's earlier point about what you looked at in other states and their ability to address disruptions.
I actually like to take this sort of from a base scientific physics principle level. And I think if you look at that, resiliency equals diversification. And I think a lot of the trends that we've seen in the Defense Department are anti-diversification. I mean, I look at Navy networks. They're a completely correlated risk. I look at what we're doing with some of the joint environments, what we're doing with some of the programs and making them very joint. To me, that is the potential for catastrophic risk. The more you take away diversification, the more you create catastrophic risk potential. And that's just physics.
Let me take the opportunity to answer my own question again, more from a military perspective. I've long argued that one of the things that makes the current U.S. military probably the most, or one of the most effective that's ever existed in history, is its resilience and adaptability, the speed and effectiveness of its ability to adapt to new settings. In fact, I think that future historians will look at what the U.S. military did in Iraq from 2003 to 2010 as probably the most stunning example of military adaptation under fire that's ever existed. But I've also argued that particular skill set is something that the U.S. military may need to pursue and focus and emphasize even more. And let me just kind of throw out one example of how I think we might do that. I mentioned that the U.S. Army and the other services as well do a whole series of long-term futures, war games and studies and things like that. Most of the ones that I've participated in over the years within either an Army or a joint context are set at some point in the future. You know, it might be 2020, 2025 or whatever. But the players in the game are then given a force and a scenario. They're said, okay, you know, here's the force you've got in 2025. You're a general. Here's the scenario. How do you use it? I've argued that we shouldn't abandon that methodology, but we might do in parallel a series of future studies or war games where we take a group of people and say, okay, it's 2025, and here is a wholly new security threat that you don't have a force that's prepared for. Now, create a force, design concepts and doctrine today, and then tomorrow we're going to take the force that you've now developed and use it against that that threat. So what I'm getting at here is that resiliency and adaptability is not just a mental agility, but it's actually the ability to change organizations and concepts under pressure. And while, you know, I, as I said, I think we're as good as any military in history has ever been at that, we can always get better. So that would be, you know, one way that I would answer the question. Yeah, way in the back, sir.
One of the themes of this three-day conference, it seems to me, has been the relationship of economics to security. And I'm curious to know if anyone has given any serious thought as a gray swan to what would happen if world markets seriously began to doubt the ability of the United States to pay off its debt. And how do people in the security area respond to that without seeming too political?
Dan, is that one you've grappled with?
No, we haven't grappled with that one exactly. We are talking about how we're seeing this change in what was, you know, Western-dominated financial institutions like the IMF, and you're seeing the rise of new institutions like the Asian Infrastructure and Development Bank, to try and kind of change the rules of the system, because other countries don't think that they are favoring their own interest. And that's something we're watching about, and that may be a gray swan to see how those change international dynamics over time.
I mean, for me, that's high enough probability. I don't even know if I'd consider it a gray swan. I think what we've seen recently going on, with the Asian Development Banks, with some of our partners not even necessarily letting us know that they're going into investments with some of the Asian countries. You know, the question is, is this always a negative? Could it be a positive? And how do we find the opportunity in it? So, I mean, I think we want to explore it from a security space, from a state space, just from a general economic space, because I do believe we can make economic opportunity out of this, some of this. But yeah, I don't think it's, I wouldn't put it in gray swan in terms of low probability.
And in the short term, I think if I agree actually with what both of the previous panelists said, but I would add that in the short term, of course, you know, the American military is still there. You can weather a little, you know, some, you know, lack of confidence. If you want to talk about, you know, the long-term impact of what would then be sort of structural American economic decline. I mean, all right, that's going to make me unhappy. You know, that's not a good place for the United States. I mean, one could argue in theory, and with those caveats, I will then say maybe the development of new Asian financial institutions that gives more actors a stake in the stability of the global economy could, in theory, make the underlying global economy more resilient over time, which could be something that actually benefited the United States, because it would give others, in the event of an actual American economic crisis, could give others a stake in helping the United States, actually.
I don't have really anything to add other than I think the system now is also open to other actors entering, as Mike said, but also actors who can enter using technology to create uncertainty in that realm, which then also has longer-term effects. Whereas in the past, it was a more controlled environment for who could manipulate markets, essentially.
And I think there are very important military strategy implications that grow from this that certainly merit additional debate and study and things like that. I mean, if you think about U.S. military strategy for several decades, has been heavily focused on regional economic stability. Well, if that's no longer the primary focus of U.S. military strategy, what might be? And would that dramatically change the military capabilities that we need as a nation? Would we still need an expeditionary military if, in fact, there are changes in the global economy where we're not trying to reassure members of, or the states in various regions, in order to preserve economic stability there. I'd like to tease out an issue that's come up a couple of times and see where we can go with this. Maura made the point very early on about kind of the emergence of corporations playing some of the roles that for several centuries at least have been played by nation states. And I mean, we all know that there's been in academic literature for years about the decline of the nation state, and it seems to be one of those things that as much as we talk about it, it's still at some point in the future. But I'll tell you an idea that I've kind of toyed with for a number of years that the panelists may want to address. It occurred to me that we have been in about a 500-year period of history where we assume that militaries are things created and owned by nation states that pursue national interest. But if we go a little further back in history, say before the Peace of Westphalia, it was true that very often there were powerful, rich, transnational companies that had militaries as powerful as many or most nations. You know, the Hanseatic League, the British East India Company, and stuff like that. That has kind of led me to wonder whether, while that was the past, it might also be the future as well. Might we reach a state where we have these transnational corporations that have global interest, or at least interest in many regions, who don't feel that a nation state is fully committed to looking out after their interest, and they therefore decide to develop military capability on their own, I mean, potentially a robust military capability. And we're already seeing the beginning of that with corporations that do business in bad places, you know, developing their own security systems. So the question I pose to the audience is, do you think it's possible that we will see corporate security organizations that can match state militaries? And if so, what might that mean?
I think this is actually a place where it goes back to what Nadia said initially about the democratization of violence, because I think the key enabling macro trend for that has to be an underlying shift in defense production, in that the modern defense production, you know, say especially starting in the late 19th, early 20th century, basically took things like the British East India Company and what they did, you know, kind of off the table, because the underlying production, industrial infrastructure you needed to generate modern military capabilities was so intense that really only states could do it. But if we now have a contrary trend with the democratization of violence and the diffusion of a new generation of technologies that can be fundamentally dual use, then that basically makes this plausible, I think, in a way that it even, you know, 30 or 40 years ago, it wouldn't necessarily be. And so, and that I think makes this, puts this in some ways in the gray swan-ish category, at least for me, because whereas 30 or 40 years ago, you could have said that in my response, say at the outset of that academic literature on the decline of the state, well, yeah, I mean, how's a private corporation, you know, where are they gonna get their tanks? You know, those kinds of things, who are they gonna buy them from? If now we're talking about cyber and robotics and other types of systems, I'm a lot less, a lot less confident in the ability of states to control the ability to use violence in that way. So I think it's a lot more conceptually plausible than it used to be.
And a kind of a flip side to that is how much, and I'm not sure about this, but how much in the past was the strength of the state based on the confluence of strong companies that were also had a confluence of interest with the state, essentially. The old model of GM, let's say, the old model of the old American companies that were also linked to keeping America strong, maybe, you know, implicitly or explicitly at a different level. And today, with multinational companies, Google, Apple, it's a much broader kind of perspective. It's a different sort of model. And I wonder sometimes if that, you know, even to my fellow panelists or the audience, how does that actually over time impact the strength of the state as the nature of these companies change and as their interests change?
I mean, there's been several books on this recently about the rise of the modern mercenaries and, you know, pointing to the U.S. dependence on private military corporations, security corporations in Afghanistan and Iraq. And the question is, you know, what life do they have of their own going forward and how do they operate? But you can imagine maybe a small state with limited resources finding it favorable to them to contract out their security force. May find it actually more economical and may be able to get some more political loyalty that way. So this is a dynamic I think we will see in the future.
And again, a return to the past, because that's exactly past, what happened right. The Renaissance in Europe.
Yeah, I think there's an interesting confluence between less casualties in warfare. I mean, isn't this the end of the the 150th anniversary of the end of the Civil War, where there was over 600,000 casualties. And now you can have a great deal of influence with very few casualties. And you combine that with the role of technology, and I think this is sort of this interesting precipice as to how that's going to reshape, because the corporate technology landscape is definitely moving within at a faster loop than we can. So I do think what it means to have influence, security influence, whether we call it military influence, is going to become more corporate with autonomy, with technology, and with casualty aversion.
And for those of you in uniform, I mean, this issue, I think, really has some profound implications because, I mean, right now, do we have a way to make a military alliance with Google? You know, I can tell you that barely a day doesn't go by that I wish we had a way to declare war on Microsoft, but that's another issue. But from a military perspective, I mean, think how much of everything that you do as a military is within a state perspective. I mean, security force development, sure, we have the ability to help non-state actors, militias, and things like that. But even then, it's to make them more state-like. But what if states no longer own the armed conflict realm and that they have some peer competitors that aren't other nations? Okay. Frank Hoffman had a question.
Thank you, Steve. Frank Hoffman, National Defense University. I'd like to get anyone on the panel to address the potential gray or black swan of a breakout in biotech technologies, particularly, not necessarily of the sinister kind, but the whole range of good and bad, and the social, the economic, and the security implications of a black swan event, and whether or not that event occurs owned by the United States, a foreign state, or an external multinational corporation, and what would be the implications of that. And if you believe that that's not likely, or if it really does fit in the black swan category.
Nothing scares me more than extreme longevity.
There was a movie about that, too.
And you notice he had
nothing
his, mic,
her
you notice
more
he had his
either.
Mic off when he said that? Do you want to expand on what you mean by that, Mark?
So I actually spent the few years of my previous career modeling the potential consequences of across the financial realm of what step changes in mortality and longevity could do. And it is my opinion that within the next 30 years, just given current rates of change, that longevity will cause major economic collapse akin to what we saw with the mortgage crisis. And there's been some mechanisms to try and hedge that across the markets, but it's very few and far between, and it's a slow and insidious enough developing threat that, and it's seen as a positive, that it probably will be too late and we won't have made the risk transfer decisions that we need to make by the time we hit that point. So just not even saying we have a step change, just saying this sort of slow rate in increase, I think that's unfortunately way closer to an inevitability than I would like it to be.
Frank, I think there's going to be a huge potential for some kind of surprise in the biotech area. One of the things that we noticed is that, the UK just agreed to testing of mitochondrial transfer, which allows basically a child born that way to would technically have three parents. And as a result, people are beginning to speculate, well, down the road, we can start doing, gene matching and choose intelligence of our offspring, eye color, hair color, all these different genetic traits. And that brings in all whole sorts of ethical, legal issues that different countries are going to have different approaches to. And how we're going to sort that all out in our relationships with them as different countries may go different ways. And the potential for surprise, I think, is a huge thing to watch.
Yeah, I mean, handling human performance enhancement at the genetic level and in that level, I mean, that'll make, like steroids in baseball look like a picnic. And I think it's absolutely right that how the United States thinks about this because of the type of country we are, because of American political institutions and America's ethos, may be very different than what other countries do. And we need to we need to think hard about, and this becomes then a forecasting task, thinking about how others will deal with this, and then what's our response.
And let me just add a comment on Mara's notion of longevity. I think that the combination of longevity and the expansion of robotics is going to force the world as a whole to undertake some major revisions in sort of the way it thinks about individual value. And what I mean by that is that for, you know, most of human history, someone's self-identity is very closely linked to the role they play in the economy. But imagine an economy of the future where, first of all, even people that work, the retirement part of their life is longer than the working part of their life, and that we have economies that are robotic enough that we don't need everyone or even most people to participate in the economy. We can have a robust economy with some small percentage of people actually participating in it. What that means is this old self-value system where someone sees their value as where they fit in the economy will have to change. I have no idea what it will change to, but potentially at least we could see technology here undercutting kind of a basic ideas and concepts and systems of identity that have existed for centuries, if not millennia. Yeah, sir, on the aisle right here.
Major General Dennis Leitch, this discussion about longevity and the previous question about finances, and we focused in that one on the China Infrastructure Bank, but it seems ironic to me that during this discussion, a number of senior leaders, particularly in the defense community, have said that the biggest threat to national security in the United States is the debt. We're now $19 trillion in debt. There's no prospect of it being mitigated in any way, and I'm kind of surprised to this point that it hasn't been part of either the black swan or gray swan that's been discussed at this point, and I wonder if you'd make a comment on it.
I think the general assumption, I think it's absolutely correct to say that from a structural perspective, the debt of the U.S. government represents a significant national security challenge. I think up to this point, global economic interdependence in some ways has mitigated the consequences of that for the U.S. economy on a year-over-year basis. And it would, now a change to that in some ways, I mean, if you want to talk about a black swan event that, you know, maybe doesn't seem connected in the first place, something that would dramatically reduce global economic interdependence in a way that essentially calling America's debt would become a viable option, something that somebody would want to do, that then becomes a very dangerous scenario.
I just note that the five criteria that I mentioned early on about what makes a state fragile, one of them was excessive national debt, because it does present problems and constrains you from being adaptable to change when it does occur.
I could personally can argue both sides of this, so I'm going to stay out of debating myself.
Yep, it's over here.
I want to pick up on one word that was said earlier, and that was velocity. And in today's world, and I know you talked about people not trusting news may not be truthful, what scares me the most is the dependence on younger people today, more and more people every day, that the internet and alternative news sources, which are really not news sources, how dangerous that can be, and velocity in today's cyber world, simple attribution of an act that could be, for whatever reasons, attributed to a state, but is really because of almost an anarchist type of thing that, with viral media, that we'd have no circuit breakers. So in your black swan, gray swan, talk to me about velocity and circuit breakers.
I think, basically, I think you're right, your analysis of the velocity problem. Maybe then that accrues to, it goes back to some of the other points that we talked about in order to mitigate the effects of velocity, We need, we go back to our earlier comments of you need resiliency, you still need some people thinking about things in more than whatever the Twitter feed is, whatever that, what is it, how many, I don't have a Twitter feed.
140
Okay, so you need to think a little bit beyond that, and maybe, since just thinking now, thinking that through, the resiliency and the strength of societies to recover from some of the problems engendered by velocity will go back to some of the more foundational issues that we've talked about.
I think it's a great risk and a great opportunity. I mean, I think everyone had this sort of fear of what a crowdsourced world looked like when it started, and then all of a sudden we start to realize Wikipedia is more accurate than the encyclopedia. That the opinions of crowds are actually better than the opinions of experts. And so, you know, you hope that the larger body in a crowdsourced environment with it able to move that fast can actually mitigate itself, that it actually is not a positive feedback cycle indefinitely. It can be in short runs, but I think we do have negative feedback cycle checks as it goes along. But yeah, that's another one where it's going to be a great risk and a great opportunity, and I don't think it's sort of the horse is out of the barn at this point, and I don't think there are things that we can do in a traditional aspect to impart truth in this information age. I think it really does become about trusting the wisdom of crowds and making sure that we do have similar societal values going forward, and those become extremely important.
I actually would disagree with my fellow panelists on that or put a word of caution in. I think it very much depends which crowds. I mean, which crowds are deciding a particular issue is important. I think you can get dangerously to a sense that we use these big terms of global and international, and those terms belie the essential competitions going on beneath the surface. People are competing, people are fighting to win, people have different ideas, different ideologies, and so I'm not so sure about, I mean, I think it would be actually another interesting sort of project almost, where you could look at a set of issues and see what the crowd says on a particular issue. And who is the crowd? Is the crowd a group of youth in the Middle East without access to alternative sources of information? Is the crowd a group of American college students? Is it more diverse? So I think there's a counterpoint.
Just one back. I'd say as long as you fit within the game theory construct, so as long as you are working with your own self-interest, I think you can accurately sort of model what people are trying to do. When that breaks down, I do believe it becomes very complex, but the crowd matters less to me as long as I know they're working in their self-interest, because then I feel at that point I can put that in a game theory construct.
Dan, did you have a comment?
No, I don't want to get involved.
let me take a swag at that from a slightly different perspective, and again, kind of back to the more purely military one. Something that I've been thinking about over the past few years is what a profound revolution it's going to be in the way militaries operate through the pervasiveness of cell phones and YouTube and Twitter and all of that kind of stuff. And I kind of first really became aware of this when I sat at my desk and kind of watched the original stage of the Egyptian revolution unfold in Twitter in real time. I mean, the fact that there are people on the ground posting pictures, you know, commenting on what was taking place as it happened. So I often go to military officers, potential commanders, and say, have you really thought about what it's going to mean for the way you operate in the future if every aspect of your operations is live cast to a global audience? I mean, no more OPSEC, no more getting a hold of the narrative, because it's going to be, there are going to be literally millions of people in real time watching your operation as it unfolds. And I think that has immense implications for, you know, force discipline, you know, as we saw with the North Charleston tragedy this week, just, you know, the repercussions of a mistake by one person and how that cascades. So I believe that this idea of the real-time live casting of military operations is something that the U.S. military really needs to think more about in the future and consider what sort of concepts, what sort of training, what sort of leader development, what sort of new doctrine we need to deal with that.
Steve, can I follow up on that theme? Steve.
Sure. Oh.
Over here.
Voice from the sky. Yeah.
I was going to save this to the end, but I think this is an appropriate time. You know, part of the panel's title is Future Regret, and what I worry about in Future Regret is not black swans, but these gray swans, or I think Mark Twain said it best. It's not the things we don't know that gets us in trouble. It's the things we think we know with certainty that turn out to be not to be true. And if I was channeling Secretary Rumsfeld, I might call these the unknown knowns. These are things that we know, but we really don't fully understand the implications of. And I think what you just mentioned is a case of that point, that we're kind of in this pre-World War I stage of we're seeing these rapid technology developments, but their impact on the character of warfare going forward, we may not really truly understand. And I think that would be a future regret. So we know that states are developing cyber capabilities. We know they're developing long-range precision weapons. We know they're doing counter-space capabilities. We might even understand the technical characteristics of that, those capabilities. What I think we're risk not understanding is the impact on the character of conflicts, because we don't have a political strategic context to put it in. So how do those weapons, when they actually get used, change escalation dynamics, change deterrence, change conflict resolution? I mean, a historical example of this was the Iraq War, when Iraq had Scud missiles, the first Gulf War. We knew they had Scud missiles. We knew they were inaccurate. We knew they're not very effective warfighting capability. But they used it as a political weapon by striking Israel. So it changed the political context. So I think that's a potential area where we could have a future regret. And I think the answer to that is to do more analytical gaming. And I applaud the DOD's initiative to bring back war gaming. I think the Army War College is well positioned to lead in that area. My only caution is I have often seen in DOD games, we have a tendency to go right to the war fighting and abstract the political context and put it in the background and say, you know, let's get on with the fight. If we do that, though, we risk not understanding these dynamics that I just talked about. So that's my future possible regret, is that the things we think we'll know, we actually will surprise us because we didn't appreciate the strategic political impact that they actually have when they get employed in the future.
While I'm seeing a whole lot of potential robust discussion in the audience here, one thing I was telling my fellow panelists when we were in the green room before we came out here is I pride myself on the fact that in 30-some years in higher education, I've never gone long. And we have about 6 more minutes left before the index in this panel. So what I'd like to do with that 6 minutes is to, first of all, ask the panelists if they have anything we didn't think of, any closing comments, anything that you expected or wished had come up in the discussion but didn't. Dan, was that?
That was my point.
That was your closing comment? Okay.
I would say for my final thought, as we see from this panel, we're living in a world of increasing complexity, and I think we still in the DOD live in a process of industrial age, very linear processes where we have beginning, middle, and ends, and we want to have that. And that is an organization that pushes you towards exact answers and pushes you towards means. And for complex problems, there are no exact answers and there are no means. It's just an exploration of distributions and an exploration of uncertainty spaces. So I would push everyone to explore the uncertainty space. And I think all that really takes is organizational honesty and a little bit of time. And for me, how I know I've done that completely is that I have a list of things on my wall for which I know I am woefully underprepared. And if you don't have that on your wall, you haven't explored the uncertainty space. And you haven't had the organizational honesty. To be world class, you have to be strong in places and you have to be weak in places. So for me, strategy is about what you choose not to do. So I just hope that we make those decisions where we're weak intentionally.
Michael?
I would say I agree with a lot of my panelists, what my fellow panelists have said, and we exist in an increasingly complex world. We exist in a world of significant technological change, but I think it's vital we don't forget about the people, and that one of the things that has made the United States so resilient and strong is, in fact, the people. And in that, I think it's assessment then that becomes critical. It's training our leaders both in the defense space and outside the defense space to be flexible and adaptable to all of these things that are coming down the pipeline, especially these things where we think we might understand the technologies involved, but how those technologies might interact in a conflict, what that might mean for the security environment, we're a lot less sure about. So I think it's the combination of people and assessment that's critical for continuing to be resilient moving forward so that we can hopefully survive some of these black swans that will inevitably come down the pipe.
And I just actually echo what Mike says. I mean, as we think about gaming and as we think about identifying future technologies, biotechnologies, processes of change, I would say not to forget about intentions, essentially. People have desires to order society and to disorder society, and I think that will remain a factor, especially after a black swan. There will be a new order. People will drive it. Intentions matter. And maybe we need to reshift a bit toward to restore a balance in thinking about that. I think we've turned today to, again, to big terms that are globalization, international, terrorism, broad terms that sometimes don't want to drive at the content of what's behind those terms. So
we all, I'm sure, have heard the old Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. And I think, you know, for better or worse, we are deeply cursed by that because these are interesting and very, very important times. You know, I can tell you several months ago when SSI was kind of thinking the conference through and thinking about different panels, I think for this one we all kind of leaned back in the room and said, let's put together a panel of the biggest brains we can find. And I think we really succeeded at that. So please join me in thanking our panelists for some provocative ideas.